sent his spirit like a flood. Children of the living God, sing to the living God.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Faith Baptist Church. Have a few brief announcements before we greet each other and dismiss our children for Children's Church. First of all, our missionary for today is Laura Fowler, former member of our church who has gone to a number of different mission fields. And her birthday is coming up September the 8th, and we'd like to send her a birthday card with a gift in it. If you'd like to make a donation towards that gift, you can place it in the offering plate and just mark it Laura Fowler, and we'll make sure she gets that. We need to have that probably this week because it has to be mailed and then gotten to her where she is. So please keep that in mind for a love offering, birthday gift for Laura Fowler, and keep her in prayer today. On the church membership slide, please choose one of those names to pray for. Ed Richards had a procedure done this week, and he's home, but I haven't been able to get in contact with him over the phone. But please pray for Penny and Ed as he recovers from his procedure. Also, out on the lobby, there's a wall that is a prayer card wall. And it's designed for us to submit our prayer request to our prayer team that meets here every Saturday, and they pray over every single one of those cards. They would like to pray for you specifically. If you have a prayer request, take the time to write it on one of those cards and just hang it on the hook. And they collect those every week and they pray about them until they're prayed for five times. Then they check them off and put them back up there. But please consider doing that. This Wednesday, we're talking about the book of Esther, one of the greatest stories in the Bible. And we're doing it from the Bible Project. And then we'll have some comments. I want to encourage you to be here this Wednesday night at 6:30. And then the next Wednesday, we start our new Wednesday night program with Jerry Daniels, our missionary to Kenya, is now living here and sort of headquartered here in Sarasota. He's going to be doing the adult Bible study in here. I'm going to be with the young adults over in the modular out there in that corner of the parking lot. It's an art classroom during the day, and for us it'll be a place for the young adults. And young adults is anybody who's a young adult, single, married, or a couple, or with children in grade school. And we're going to talk about practical aspects of living, and our first topic is going to be authenticity. What is that? Do we need it? And do we even know for sure how to best achieve it? That'll be a week from this Wednesday. Also, for all those who are our guests, we have a very special gift to give you. It's a coffee mug full of some Hershey's Kisses, and I thank you for being with us today. If you receive one of our postcards in the mail that welcomes you to the community, be sure and turn that in, or you can just go there yourself and turn in your guest card, and they'll give you one of these. If you're a member and you'd like to have one, you can buy one for $10, and that helps refund the coffee cart, so we can continue to give these away as gifts. But if you like coffee, it's a great cup to put your coffee in. Also, you may have seen in your bulletin the dreaded Hello, My Name Is sticker. For the next 4 or 5 weeks, we're going to do this every Sunday because we've heard from a number of people. There's been so many transitions in the church that people are a little self-conscious of saying hi to somebody that they should know their name because they've seen their face for 2 years but don't know their name or can't recall it. And it makes people not be as friendly as they would want to. And it doesn't take much to pull back into your corner and not say hi to anybody. So we want to sort of eliminate that fear. Put your name, address, social security number, and your bank account on that. Put your name, if you don't mind, and put it right here so people can see your name. And then today, after church, I want you to walk up to somebody and say hello. And don't worry about looking down their name tag. We're all going to look at these little stickers for a couple of weeks to get reacquainted. And we have a lot of people moving into our area. And as they come and become part of our church family, we need to make sure we know each other first as we get to know them as well. So please do that today and for the next couple of weeks. And while the ushers prepare for this morning's offering, let's all please stand. And as we take a moment to greet one another, we're going to ask for all the children to go out that door right back there and follow the children into Kids Under Construction. You can follow Nate. He's wearing the bright green t-shirt. We're going to go out that door right back there. All the children, take a moment to shake hands with those around you. Make sure they feel welcome. Okay, if you'd return to your seat, we'll ask the Lord to bless this morning's offering and the worship for the day, that we'll have a great time together as a church family. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the privilege to be together today, and we thank you we get the chance to be with each other in your presence, and we ask that you bless this service and that you also bless this offering and each person who gives. We pray for our president, vice president, and members of Congress, that you'll continue to bring to bear in their life truth speakers who will hold up the word of God, at least the principles of virtue, morality, and truth to them, that you will govern and guide their decisions, encourage them when they need to be brave, and correct them when they are wrong. For the members of the United States Supreme Court, that they will humbly sit there as they adjudicate and realize that you are the great judge of the universe. For all of our men and women stationed around the world and the United States Armed Forces, we pray that you will bless them and hold their hearts secure as they're away from families and may even be at risk, that you'll keep them safe, make their mission successful, and bring them home soon. For those in our church family who are in law enforcement and fire and rescue, that you'll bless them for their ministry to us and the fact that they keep us safe and would be here in a heartbeat in case of emergency. May you protect them as well. For our missionaries around the world, we ask you to use their ministries today to bring people to Christ, to encourage believers, and that you will encourage them specifically, that they are not forgotten, that they are loved, and that you're using them, and let them see the fruit of their labor. We pray for Laura Fowler, our missionary, that you will bless her and use her, expand her ministry, and let her know that we are thinking of her, and may our birthday gift to her be a blessing. Then for this day, we ask you to open up our hearts and minds to truly sing with a sense of worship, and then to open our minds to the Word of God, that we might learn what you would have us to learn today and apply it to our lives. May you bless this offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, I come and I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. 'Cause without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. And Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, you're my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are, and where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Oh God, how I need you. Oh, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, you're my righteousness. Oh God. need you. You are my one defense. You're my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Amen. Let's stand together. Let that be our prayer this morning, that in everything we do in this service, that we depend fully on Him and Him alone.
Worthy is the Lamb, for you are holy.
this next song might be a new one for you all. So I just want to teach you guys the chorus. It's really simple. It goes something like this.
Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. And be lifted up. And be lifted higher. And be lifted up, be lifted higher. And I sing praises to your name, praises to your name, the name that's so much higher. In all names,
all honor,
and all honor to your name, honor to your name, the name that's so much greater than all names.
Lift it up.
Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher.
I sing praises.
And I sing praises to your name, praises to your name, the name that's so much higher than all names.
All honor. Lifted up.
Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher.
Be lifted up.
Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Your name is life, your name is hope inside me, hope inside me. Your name is love, a love that always finds me, always finds me. Your name is life, your name is hope inside me. Hope. hope inside me. Your name is love, a love that always finds me, always finds me. Let's sing it out, be lifted up. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher.
Let's sing it one more time. Be lifted up.
Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. And amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. Forever mine.
Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. There's a topic that's foundational and critical to Christianity, but it's often overlooked or ignored or even avoided because some think it's too hard to understand. Some think it's irrelevant. Some people think it's too sensationalized. But one out of every 25 verses in the New Testament refer to this topic. All nine of the New Testament authors refer to it and do so often. Jesus spoke about it a great deal and even preached an entire message about it in Matthew 24 through 25 that we call the Olivet Discourse. Before he ascended into heaven, Christ returned to the Mount of Olives, and he rose into heaven after he gave his last exhortation. And as the disciples watched him rise up into heaven, two angels appeared, and they said to them this, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken from you up into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven." So the topic for today and the next two Sundays is the return of Christ. And right when you hear that, some of you go, "Oh no, not prophecy. I don't like prophecy. It gets complicated, it gets confusing, it gets scary." Or some of you are automatically thinking, "Well, when is the rapture going to happen? Is it going to happen before the tribulation, in the middle of the tribulation, after the tribulation? Is it going to happen at all?" Put all those things aside, if you would. Sometimes the how and the when of Christ's return and the what accompanies Christ's return overshadows the incredible, miraculous truth that he's coming back. We stop reflecting on that because we want to figure it out. And the disciples sort of had that same approach when they asked him a question in Matthew 24. So before we start to chart it out and diagram all that's going to happen, and we start arguing about it and labeling each other as liberals or conservatives or evangelicals or reform or Catholic, whatever, before we start doing all that, let's just marvel at it, be humbled by it, rejoice in it, and even love it. The Apostle Paul said there's a special crown reserved for those who love Christ appearing. Now, that does not mean loves prophecy conferences. It doesn't mean somebody who loves eschatology charts. It doesn't mean somebody who loves to figure out what the ten horns are, or the little horn is, or the big horn is, or the seven seals, or the seven trumpets, or the mark of the beast, and who's got it, and when's it coming. That doesn't mean that you don't love the return of Christ, but that's not what he's talking about. Loving the return of Christ is a personal anticipation and expectation of Jesus coming back for us. And sometimes we lose that in the minutiae and the theological discussions of how is it going to play out. Over the years that I've been a pastor, I've seen many dear Christians disassociate with others because of their position on when the rapture happens, or worse of all, believing the rapture doesn't even happen, or not thinking the millennium is going to happen when you think it's going to happen, and we go into theological camps and don't associate with each other. And I would say, I've noticed many times that our spiritual zeal for a spiritual reality often becomes an exercise in the flesh. If there's one thing that should unify us all, is that our Savior is coming back. The how and the when and the where and the what and how it all plays out, God knows, and it's going to happen exactly as he thinks it is and says it is. We might not truly understand it until the day it actually unfolds. But let's not overlook the fact that it does occur. In Matthew chapter 24, turn there in your Bibles if you would, and we're going to see what happens in this conversation from Olivet. For centuries, Israel had eagerly and anxiously and even desperately looked for the Messiah. They believed he was coming, and they had an entire concept of what was going to take place. From the Psalms, the book of Jeremiah, Isaiah, Daniel, Zechariah, the apocryphal books, the second book of Baruch, the second Esdras, the Mishnah, collection of Jewish writings, and the book of Enoch, a timeline had already developed before Jesus even got there. So they were expecting a great time of tribulation, the arrival of Elijah, and then the Messiah showing up, the armies of the world being defeated, Jerusalem being restored, Palestine being made the center of the world, and then the great, eternal, glorious kingdom of the Messiah being set up and Israel being on top. That's what they were already thinking before Jesus ever got there. So in Matthew 24, we have Christ's response to this fever pitch anticipation, which had caused Israel already to have a number of revolts against Rome, all of which were crushed. Look at verse 1. Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, "Do you not see all these things? As surely I say to you, not one stone shall be left upon another that shall not be thrown down." He begins his dissertation with the most alarming fact they could possibly imagine. This was inconceivable to them. Theologically, spiritually, nationally, and even physically, this could not happen. Some of these stones were 40 feet long, 12 feet high, and 12 feet wide, and weighed hundreds of tons. You can still see some of them today. They can't even imagine, first of all, the temple being destroyed after so much effort was put into rebuilding it. And then how could these stones be knocked off the other? But that's exactly what happened just a few years later. All the stones were removed except the big foundational stones and some of the cornerstones. But the stones were taken down as the Romans looked for gold. So verse 3. Now as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, "Tell us, when will these things be? What will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" So they had three main questions. When will the temple be destroyed? What will precede your full manifestation as the king? And when will your kingdom be established and end man's rule of rebellion and sin? Look what his answer is in verse 4. And he answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you." The first thing that Christ brings up in responding to the when and the how and the what are the signs is, don't be deceived. This is how critical this doctrine is to the church. So critical that Satan is going to try to obfuscate it with generations of deceit. So he said, don't be deceived. He's going to tell them why in just a moment, but do not be deceived. Paul says to the Thessalonians, "Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day, the day of the Lord, will not come unless the falling away comes first. And the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God." This is a critical, historical, profound event. The return of Christ that is preceded by the rise of somebody else. The rise of what we call the Antichrist. The rise of the man of sin, the son of perdition, will fully manifest himself before Christ comes back. And then he gives a very foreboding answer to the question, what are the signs that we're getting close? That's in verse 5. "For many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold." So he paints this picture of where the world is headed. False messiahs, wars, famine, pestilences, earthquakes, and that's just the beginning. Followed by incredible tribulation, persecution, false believers betraying true believers, more false prophets, lawlessness, and then cold hearts. And then he makes this statement, "But he who endures to the end shall be saved." Now, this is what indicates to us this is a future event from Jesus' day, because nobody who was alive in Jesus' day endured to the end. They all died. Nobody in the last 2,000 years has endured to the end. They have all died. This is a generation who sees this happen, he's talking about. The believers who are alive in that moment, who, when they, if they endure, they're going to be delivered. They will be saved. So verse 14. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. There are many signs in that passage that we just read, and this is one of them, that often get brought up in at websites and prophecy conferences as this has just happened, and now we've crossed over that line, and we're getting that much closer. I don't know if any of those things have actually happened yet, but I do know we're 2,000 years closer than when Jesus said this. That ought to alarm us enough and perk up our ears enough that we've gone 2,000 years down this calendar. But any particular thing, after Billy Graham prayed at the inauguration of George Bush, I believe it was, the word went out that that prayer of Franklin Graham in the National Cathedral was broadcast to the entire world. And all the websites lit up with, it happened. The whole world has heard the gospel. This has now been fulfilled. Christ can come back at any time. Well, when Jesus said this to the disciples, this was theoretically and physically impossible to happen in the apostles' day for the gospel to go literally around the world. Even today, with what we have with the internet and satellite TV and the global media abilities, there are millions of people, maybe even billions, who've never heard the gospel. Some have never even heard the name Jesus. So when Christ said, the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come, he might be referring to what John portrays in Revelation 14, a miraculous witness. In verse 6 and 7, John writes, I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the seas and the springs of water. So in John's portrayal of the end, an angel comes flying across the heavens and speaks out in every tongue so everybody can hear this gospel witness. Maybe that's what Christ is referring to. All we know is everybody's going to hear, and we're not even close to that. All the missions organizations will tell you there are still people groups who've never heard the name of Jesus. There are people in China and India who've never, ever heard the name Jesus. You would think that is absolutely impossible, but it's true. We're not even close to getting the gospel all around the world. And it's not that we have to do it. The Lord is going to communicate it evidently in some miraculous sense, but that is in the period of this great trial of tribulation. Then in verse 15 he says, therefore when you see the abomination of desolation, the Antichrist himself, spoken by Daniel the prophet, that was in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, standing in the holy place, presenting himself as God, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, for then there will be great tribulation, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be. There is a time of tribulation coming to the world that we cannot even imagine. It goes beyond the Black Plague or the bubonic plague. It goes beyond the deaths of World War I and the deaths of World War II and the pogroms of Russia and the communist annihilations and the wiping out of entire groups of people in almost every country on earth that has happened. It's far beyond that. Whatever is coming to the earth, the world has never seen anything like it before. It will be unmistakable as to what it is. And one of the things that makes that happen, Paul says in 2 Thessalonians 2, he who restrains the Holy Spirit is going to be taken out of the way. The Holy Spirit's not going to be removed from the earth, but is going to step out of the way of blocking the progress of evil. Because the Holy Spirit is still very active during the tribulation, calling believers to Christ. People are converted during the tribulation, and you can't get converted without the regenerative work of the Holy Spirit. But he gets out of the way of holding back evil, which allows evil to move forward at an incredible rate. These are the words of Jesus. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. In Revelation 6 through 19, you have the seven seals, the bowls, and the trumpets. And those all portray to us, if it happened today, it equals 4 billion deaths. Half the world will die in this small segment of time called the tribulation. Verse 23, that if anyone says to you, look, here is Christ, or there, do not believe it. For false Christ and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. See, I have told you beforehand. Therefore, if they say to you, look, he's in the desert, do not go out. Or look, he's in the inner rooms, do not believe it. For as the lightning cometh from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. It will be visible, noticeable, physical, undeniable, and unmistakable. Everyone will know what it is that they just saw happen. It's going to be clearly designated the return, of the, just like lightning appears in the sky. When I was at Liberty, it was in the middle of the 70s during the great evangelical, eschatological rapture fever of the 70s, and we had just had a big revival at school, and some of our guys on my football team, they went home for the weekend, and they went home for the weekend and went to go see a movie. At that time at Liberty, you weren't allowed to see movies. You couldn't go see movies, you couldn't go to dances, and you couldn't hold hands on campus. They had all these kind of rules, and so when people went home, they tend just to lose complete control and go see a movie. So these guys went to go see a movie, and they're in the movie, and a lightning storm, thunderstorm, hits. And it is so loud that it shakes the theater they're in. All the power goes off, and these are some big, strong, tough guys. They go running out of the theater with everybody else, thinking the end has come. And they go outside, and they stand outside the theater, and this black and this lightning thunder. The storm soon passes away. And after they got done repenting and confessing and asking God to forgive them, they'll never see another movie, they went back in to watch the rest of the movie. But the idea that it's going to be so easily manifestable that you cannot deny, it's not going to be just a rumor. Oh, did Christ come back? And is he over there somewhere? It's going to be like lightning in the sky. Immediately, verse 29. After the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Cosmological signs that are also indisputable and profound. These aren't the kind of things that you often hear when you're listening to websites or Christian television, that there's an alignment of the stars in a certain way. These are going to be, the sun gets dark, the moon doesn't give light, stars appear to be falling out of the sky. It's like galactic fireworks. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn. It's not going to be an exciting day for the world. And they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. It will frighten them. I had a friend in high school who went to Wake Forest University on a football scholarship. He was a year older than me. So he came home after the break, and I was still a senior at Gaithersburg High School. And he said, you're not going to believe what we had the chance to do. We played Oklahoma University in a football game. Oklahoma had just won the national championship the year before, and they ended up winning it that year. And Wake Forest was like a fledgling football team from the ACC, couldn't really do anything just yet. They went there and they lost 72-0. But he said it was the greatest football experience of his life. He said, we're out there doing our warm-ups and our stretching out, and the Oklahoma team hadn't come out yet. He goes, and all of a sudden, he goes, they start playing this song, and the stadium starts singing back and forth, and smoke blows off, and all of a sudden, these monsters come running out of the dugout right past where they were exercising. And he told me, he goes, the game was won right then. He said, we were petrified the minute we saw them. Imagine what the world will be like when they see Christ coming in the clouds, surrounded by what he's going to describe in a minute. Abject fear, mourning, grievance. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. His return is glorious, it's wonderful, and it's magnificent, but not for everybody. In Revelation 6, the Bible says the kings and the mighty men will hide in the caves and the dens and cry out for the rocks to fall upon them out of fear. One of the great illustrations we've seen in our lifetime is Saddam Hussein hiding in a hole from the American troops. A great world leader who led his country with an iron fist was hiding in a hole when the American troops came in. These great kings will be hiding in caves. For many, the new message of the church is love wins, and love does win. But the victory is reserved to those who have responded to the gospel, who've responded to God's love by accepting and trusting and believing in God's Son. Those are the ones who win. Everybody else loses. And I don't say that out of glee. It's a sad and a fearful fact. But to say anything else other than that is not to be true to Scripture. No matter how much people want to hear it, or how much we wish it weren't true. Love wins doesn't apply to everybody. Love wins applies to believers in Jesus Christ only. That's the exclusivity of the gospel. It's not all-embracive. It's offered to everyone, but only applies to those who believe. Look at verse 31. And he will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. A hint that maybe we're not even here when this all unfolds. We're gathered from heaven. Verse 32, now learn this parable from the fig tree. When its branch has already become tender and put forth leaves, you know that summer is near. So you also, when you see all these things, know that it is near at the doors. Assuredly, I say to you, this generation will by no means pass away till all these things take place. Now, let me give you a prophetic warning here. I would just simply set aside everything you ever hear about a date of when Jesus is coming back or some event that is now unfolded and now it's the time. Just toss it aside. This was the first one that I remember. I'm an impressionable ninth grader here at Faith Baptist Church. And I hear this message here. I heard it someplace else. Everybody was using this passage to say the fig tree is Israel. It budded its leaves in 1948 when it became a nation. You take one generation, which based upon the Bible teacher is either 43 years or all the way up to 70. You add 43 years to 19. To 1948, what do you have? 1991. You take off 7 years for the tribulation, what do you have? 1984. This is 1972 when I'm hearing this stuff. I got 12 years, tops. It was a guarantee Christ is coming back before 1984. It petrified all of us teenagers. We're going to get to miss out on everything because Jesus is coming back before 1984. 84 came and went. Then there was the 1988 craze that had everybody scared to death that he was coming back on Rosh Hashanah 1988. And there's been so many of those since then, they're too many to list. They all have, you know, two things in common. They're incredibly presumptuous and they're all wrong. So just toss them to the side. There's always an alignment of the planet somewhere. There's always a mysterious star traveling by. There's always a sign in the heavens somewhere. There's always some unique Rosh Hashanah coming up. There's always some sign of something that tells you it's around the corner. I think if Alabama wins one more national championship, we should all look up to heaven. It's got to be time to go. But there are some signs, but we're not going to know. Don't get caught up. Because if it is one of the things, and it is happening, you can't do anything to stop it. Not a thing you can do. Nobody can stop the return of the Savior, and as a believer, we wouldn't even want to. That's not the purpose of the teachings of Christ's return. It's for us to figure it all out and be the only person who really knows, because it's not going to make any difference whatsoever. Verse 35, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. Earth and heaven are going to pass away, which is why in Revelation, there's a new heaven, there's a new earth. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. No man, not even Satan, knows the exact time. So there are many Bible scholars who believe Satan always has an Antichrist in the next slot, like a Pez dispenser, ready to come out, because he never knows when it's going to happen. The Father knows, and of course the Son knows in heaven. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark. That just simply means they were going about life as usual. No sense of doom. And did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. And then Matthew goes on with this unusual description of something that's going to happen. One will be in the field, one will be in the house, one will be on the roof, one will be here, one will be taken, one left behind. And for years that's been taken to be a portrayal of the rapture. But that's not really what he's talking about. He's talking about judgment. The flood took them away. Those taken away are taken away to judgment. It's not a passage on the rapture. It's on the inescapable, inevitable result of God judging the earth. And then Christ sort of wraps this part up with these phrases. Verse 42, verse 44, and then on into chapter 25. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. Therefore be also ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. 25:13, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. The Lord mentioned he's coming soon, and he's coming at any time. For 2,000 years, believers have been looking up, longing and waiting and hoping, anticipating, sometimes even trying to plan it out. But the Lord tells us, just be ready because you don't know. And by ready, he doesn't mean be ready so that you can go with him. It means live your life with the preparation in mind that my Savior is coming back. Don't waste your days, because he could come at any time. Any day could be your very last. So verse 25:31. Jesus says, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. Imagine that scene. Christ coming back, glorious, magnificent, joyful, triumphant, astounding, surrounded by all the holy angels. And Revelation tells us there's a whole other group coming with him, and it's believers on horses, him in the front. It's going to be an amazing scene. But it's not going to be a good scene for everybody. In verse 32 of chapter 25, Jesus says, all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. Then he will also say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. So for believers, the return of Christ is nothing to fear, and it's nothing to wish it to be delayed. There is nothing here in this life that will not be infinitely surpassed by the realities of heaven. If the rapture is the next thing on the prophetic calendar, that means he's coming back for us before he comes back with us. That's the promise to you and me. If you read through Matthew 24 and 25 later on today or this week, and I would suggest you do it, to get the import, to get the intensity of Christ's message from all of it. This is Jesus, the great, gentle, loving, kind, forgiving, compassionate Jesus. He's saying this very dark, strong, frightening promise. I'm coming back, and I'm coming back in judgment, but I'm coming back for you. It's a very critical belief to the believers. But we want to focus on other things. And, you know, maybe rightfully so, because we have to live life. But don't overlook this amazing promise out of the mouth of Jesus I'm coming back. So when John wrote about it in Revelation, when he gets to the end of his book, and he thinks about all these things that are going to happen, he simply voices them like a confession. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. How present is that thought in your mind as a believer? Do you think about him coming back? Do you long for him to come back? Do you realize that every trial, tribulation, heartache, disappointment, loss will all just dissipate into nothingness when he comes back, to the point that Paul said that I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not even worthy to be compared to the glory that he shall reveal in us? And then as we'll see next week and the week after, when he comes back, he's coming back to take us somewhere amazing. Not just amazing, unimaginable, inconceivable, beyond our grasp. There is nothing for a believer to fear or to dread about the second coming of Christ if we're living ready. Let's bow together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the great promise of Christ's return, that his work of salvation is done, but his work here on earth is not. That he's left us here to be evangelists, to edify and encourage one another, to live lives of salt and light, and not to usher in your return, but to be ready when you do. That day is already appointed. Father, I pray for every Christian here that we will pause long enough to contemplate this truth and let it affect the way that we act during the day. May it impact our emotions. May it impact our mood. May it impact the way we treat others. May we seize the day, since this could be our last. Father, we thank you also for the great promises that follow his return. Elevate our sight above the hardships and disappointments of this life. For believers who are facing persecution right now in the world, who their very lives are at stake, they've been taken from families, they've been imprisoned, or they've had family members killed right in front of their eyes. May you encourage them with this promise. And then, Father, prepare us for the days that you say are coming, whether it's in our lifetime or not, that the world will someday hate us and oppose us at every turn. May we not react with fear and anger and hate, but with the love of Christ and the faith that you're coming back for us. Let me give you a moment to quietly contemplate the words of the message as to what the Lord may have said to you today, what he wants from you, what changes he might want you to make, or things he might want you to remove from your life or add to it. But if Christ is coming back as he says he is, it'll be the most amazing day in world history. Nothing will ever be the same. Father, help each one of us to respond to these truths in a way that will honor and please you, with our heads up, our hearts full of joy, our faith going deeper, the assurance of our deliverance being more concrete in our hearts and minds than ever before. Help us not to be people of fear, but of courage and strength in a world that is rapidly changing. May we be the salt and light that you've designed us to be. For we ask that in Christ's name. Amen. After this second message on Olivet, when he ascended into heaven, this begins the launch of the church, New Testament church. It's in the book of Acts. In the after church Bible class today, we're going to look at the book of Acts, part one, in the Bible Projects video. Then we're going to talk about what happens to this group of people who are still a little bit bewildered and confused. They saw their Messiah killed, buried. They saw he rose from the dead, and that changed them. But now they thought, surely it's time for the kingdom.